And now for something completely different.
Here's what's coming up this hour on Today's Experience. It's wild and wonderful. What's going to happen? We have no idea. So let's sit back and enjoy the ride. Can I get a Wowzer Bowser Wednesday? Because God's in charge of this crazy bus called The Christian Journey. First, one of the greatest teachings for all of us to grasp comes from the Sermon on the Mount, where Jesus instructs people on how to pray. At the beginning, the very beginning of this process, he presents a model, not with the intention that the exact words need to be quoted, but rather to provide a structure for us to follow. Within the framework of that prayer is the statement, "Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven." This model prayer serves as a guide for how we should align our desires with God's will and seek his kingdom in our lives daily. Next, there is a future reign that is going to take place, which is undeniable. Come, Lord Jesus, come. However, there is also a current reign that is supposed to manifest in our individual lives as we're living. The kingdom of God is both now and later. The message, this message, focuses on the now, on moving forward in God so that his kingdom is established in every area of our lives. Finally, we'll focus on access points to the kingdom of God. If it is God's desire to bring his kingdom into every area of our lives, then it should be our desire as well. So this raises the question, what should we do to bring every area of our lives under God's kingship? Since the kingdom of God is where God is king, we are going to examine and answer that question. We will explore best steps that can help us submit our lives to God's authority and experience the fullness of his kingdom here and now.
David Spoon's life has been an experience. While growing up in a Jewish family, he made a wrong turn towards drug abuse. Then David Spoon found Jesus Christ, and his life completely changed. The more he studied the gospel, the more he wanted to share his experiences with others. After 35 years of ministry, David discovered a new path of service. He joined KAAM, and this radio program began. You're about to hear the David Spoon Experience.
Welcome to the David Spoon Experience, local, national, and heavenly talk. Here's what else we're looking at during the show. Lessons for surviving, living, and prevailing. Politics, entertainment, and current events. Personal revelations, spiritual observations, my life's insanities, and oy vey, so much more. Now remember, my friends, remember, it's not professional radio. We're going to ask the servant of professional radio, our very own Jamming Jacob, because you can't do any better in life than being the servant, according to Jesus. Servant of professional radio, our own Jamming Jacob, is the David Spoon Experience professional radio?
No, it is not, David.
There you go. Now that, by the way, is the highest title I've given you yet. Servant, because that's what Jesus said to be. Ah, there you go.
Like that one. I'm just impressed you haven't run out of any more titles for me. You come up with new ones, and yeah, how much longer? Okay. Like 3 years from now, you're like, I feel like I haven't used this one before.
Well, I will say that I do it spontaneously, so I'm just letting you know how it goes.
All right. So it's not planned. You just make it up on the spot?
Nope. Right on the spot, within 10 seconds of
me saying
that.
Wow, that's even more impressive.
Here's the bottom line. The bottom line is, this isn't a professional radio show. I've already made maybe 15 mistakes in my speaking. And at first I thought, boy, I hope this is the message the Lord wants as I was teaching that last segment. But if you heard it, the fill that came in right after it, which I have nothing to do with, was exactly what I was teaching on. And it's just like, that just makes you like go, yay. It means the Lord's talking to somebody. Somebody's getting ministered to. That's cool. But here's the bottom line. We want you to reach out to us. So you can do that a couple of different ways. You can send an email. Totally safe. I think most people understand it. Email, electronic mail. Hello. You can send it to david@hemusincrease.org. That's david@hemusincrease.org. You can text 214-210-8483. That's 214-210-8483. Or you can call us. That's right. 972-445-0770. That's 972-445-0770. And when you call 972-445-0770, you'll end up talking to Jammin' Jacob. You know, I got to ask you, before I even say this, what it's like talking to you. Are you going to have a different song for October? I just have to ask that now because of the September song.
I've been trying to think of a song to do for October, but I will be doing this for the rest of the month, but I'm going to try. Going to try to think of something.
All right, now I'll go back to this. So talking to Jammin' Jacob is like waking up and feeling like you got a great night's sleep.
Thank you, David. Happy Wednesday.
Happy Wednesday to you, my friend. That just shows you we don't do everything in order.
You introduce me, I start talking, and then, yeah.
Then you go back. It's like, listen, this is part of life. Enjoy life, will you please? I mean, as much as you can. Look, I want the trumpet to blow. I want it to be over before this show is over. But I'm not going to sit there and bang my head against a nail in the wall until it arrives, okay? That's just my take on that, right? The Bible says, occupy, Jesus said, until I come. All right, so here's the bottom line. Why would you reach out to us? Well, you might reach out to us by phone or by text or by email because you have a praise report, and we'd love to hear it. Maybe the Lord has done something for you that is just a blessing, and it's just really helped you, and you know it. You should testify to that. I encourage you. If I could manipulate you into testifying, I would. Only because it brings glory to God. Okay? Not my manipulation, your testifying. Or me testifying. It honors the Lord. And I could probably spend a lot more time testifying because, you know, the Lord's really, really blessed my life with so many things. But I want people to also do it with me so that we can do it as a family. Maybe you've got a prayer request. You got something that you need prayer for. So we had Samson, our little brother, call in. He's going to the doctor. He needs prayer. He's not feeling comfortable. I understand that feeling. I think the older you get, to be truthful, and the more often you go to the doctor, the less comfortable it becomes. The lollipops don't seem to help as much. I'm just saying. So, yeah. So if you got something you need prayer for, let's pray about it. Let's bring it before the Lord. You got something that's on your heart and mind, let's talk about it. If you're discouraged because of things that have happened in politics, I just want to do this real fast because I love you. So just hold on. Ready? Bad boy, bad girl, stop that. Tie your happiness and joy to that kind of thing. That's silly. You tie it to the rock, Jesus Christ. The same yesterday, today, and forever. Get it? Okay, good. All right, so maybe you've got something you want to share. Maybe you've got a scripture, something going on. Our goal here is to encourage one another as we see the day of Christ getting closer and closer. Hebrews chapter 10, verse 25. Maybe you've got an answer for Bible trivia. We already did one. Let's see if we can do another. I think we can. Here we go. What was the name of the person who ultimately ordered the execution of 450 priests after a spiritual battle in front of people? What was the name of the person or the prophet who ordered the execution of 450 priests? 1 Kings chapter 18, verse 22. 1 Kings chapter 18, verse 40. That would be the question. If you know the answer, 972-445-0770. That's 972-445-0770. You can also text 214-210-8483. That's 214-210-8483. Or. You can send an email, david@hemusincrease.org. It's a pretty straightforward question. What was the name of the prophet who ordered the execution of 450 priests? 1 Kings chapter 18, verse 22, and verse 40. Wow. That's kind of like da-da-da, right? Kind of how it feels. Okay, did you like that? Da-da-da. Okay. You know what we didn't do? We didn't send people to the website, did we? Okay, I got to do. Can that person hold on for a second? Yeah? Okay. All right, we do need to send you to the website. Here's why. Money helps. I don't know how else to say it. Money helps. Get that? All right. Luke 6:38, given will be given to you. Good measure, pressed down, shaken together, running over. Be put into your lap. For the measure you use, it will be measured back to you. Please check out our stuff on the website. There's a lot of cool stuff, plus a place to give. Check it out on hemusincrease.org.
Prayer request?
HeMustIncrease.org.
Praise report?
HeMustIncrease.org.
Looking to give to this ministry?
HeMustIncrease.org.
Confused by what's happening right now?
HeMustIncrease.org.
HeMustIncrease.org.
That's so cheerful. All right, we do have somebody ready to answer a trivia question. Let's send them on through. Knock, knock, this is David. Who am I talking to?
This is Nancy.
Hi, Nancy. How are you?
I think I've got the answer wrong, but you can coach me through it, right?
I can absolutely get you through it, okay? I'm going to literally walk you through it, okay? All right,
okay.
You ready? I'll set you up and just follow the lead, okay?
Uh-huh.
Which very powerful Old Testament prophet... Very, very powerful Old Testament prophet. First one to manifest the way this was manifesting. Ordered the execution of 450 priests of Baal after he had fire come down from a little exhibition. What was the name of that prophet?
Okay. The thing is, I thought it was Jezebel's people, right? It was her prophet, her priest.
Her priests that were executed,
yes.
Correct.
Okay. Well, that was my answer. I didn't hear it correctly.
That's okay. So if there's two really powerful prophets, one that followed the other, and they both had a first initial that was the same, what was the first one's name? He came, that in fact, John the Baptist came in the same kind of style ministry as this one.
Okay.
Do you know who?
I do, but I can't think of his name right now.
Okay.
I know there's two of them in there. Give me the first letter.
Okay. E is the first number. L.
Oh, Elijah.
That is correct, Amanda! So I probably should have been more clear on the priest part, although the first Kings 18:22 might have been a key. But yeah, after that,
well,
they had done that, that was the key where he said, okay. And then Jezebel said, I'm going to kill you. I'm going to do the same thing you did
to
those priests.
Yeah, he went away. And...
Yeah. Then we won't say he ran away. He ran away. Anyway, he ducked and covered no matter what anybody says. It's like, that's what he did. But because even the powerful, powerful prophets had very, very strenuous moments.
Yes. And there was first Elijah and then there was Elisha.
Right.
Who had a double portion.
Right. Yeah. So this was Elijah, the first
that.
One. Yeah, you got
it.
Yeah, you knew it. You just had to get the brain jogged and get it going. It's like, that's no big deal. That's okay. All right,
I've been decorating cookies this morning.
So the cookie odor has taken your mind away from the things.
It was the gluten and the cookies, which I can't have gluten. So it was the gluten and the cookies that just got into my brain and just messed things up.
That's awesome. That's awesome. I'm just going to write that
down. And actually, it was a working interview because she told me to be there at 10 this morning. I didn't have to go Monday after all, but she wanted me at 10 this morning. And when I walked in, she says, yeah, I know you're a really good artist, but I don't know if you can decorate cookies. And I went, okay, well, let's try it. And it turned into a 3.5-hour interview. And I did some flub ups and stuff. And she says, oh, don't worry, somebody will like it. and all kinds of encouraging. So,
yeah.
You know, we'll wait and see if this is where the Lord wants me or not.
Yeah, and that's the thing to remember is that if the Lord wants you there doing it, and you've presented yourself, you'll be there. Emphasis is nothing else. It's like, okay.
Yes.
I mean, that's how the Lord operates. So the most weird things come about, and you think, I didn't see that happening at all. It's like, yeah, the Lord's like, I did.
I know.
Awesome. Well, can I pray for you? Am I going to pray for you on that job or what?
Sure. Yes.
Okay.
Please.
Let's just pray that the Lord, let's just pray His perfect will is done, because that's what we want, right? Let's do that. Father, we come before you right now. I lift up my sister Nancy to you, and I ask you in the name of Jesus Christ that you would give her this great sense of confidence that actually from all the things she can't figure out, there's not one of those that you can't figure out, and that you have it all in the palm of your hand, including her. And she doesn't have to worry about it. She doesn't have to stress on it. She can do her best and pray that it's blessed and let you take care of the rest. And there's nothing else to do except to do it unto honor in your name. And we just ask you to give her that confidence that you are her first actual partner in all things, in business adventures and in life itself. And she can count on you as you are always faithful. We ask you to bless her, encourage her, and strengthen her. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen and amen.
Amen.
Amen. There you go. Very, very good. And I'm praying for
Elijah.
Elijah. I'll tell you something. Somebody's going to say 450 priests. You're going to stand up in the middle of church and go, Elijah! Elijah!
I mean, that's I know. If I don't forget again.
Well, you won't be making cookies in the middle of church probably, so odds are good.
Right. I don't know. No, I won't. Never mind. You never know with me. You're never sure what I'm going to be doing. So.
Yeah, that's why you fit in.
Yeah, I know, I do.
All right, excellent call. Great job. Okay, and I'm praying for the other endeavor, so Noel, I'm letting Noel run it. You guys let me know.
Okay. Yeah, I'm going to try not to bring you up too many times.
Yeah.
All right.
God bless you. Thank you for calling, by the way.
God bless you. Thank you. Bye.
Bye-bye. All right. How much fun do we have? We have fun because it's fun. Okay, let me do a little bit of teaching, then we'll do our DNA after, but I want you to catch this. It's really important. So these are the kind of things that we talk about. And for those that didn't catch it, in the first 30 minutes, I talked about people who've hurt one another. And I talked about it, and I didn't know why it was going that way. And then right afterwards, in the fill, it talked about people hurting one another. Oh, see, that's just grace. I'm just telling you right now. I just love that. All right, listen. Matthew 6, 31 through 34. Just listen. Everybody needs this. Everybody needs this. Matthew 6, 31 through 34. Do not worry then, saying what we will eat or what we will drink or what will we wear for clothing. For the Gentiles eagerly seek all these things, for your heavenly Father knows that you need all these things. But seek first his kingdom and his righteousness, and all these things will be added to you. Verse 34. So do not worry about tomorrow. For tomorrow will care for itself. Each day has enough trouble of its own. Now, I want you to understand something, and this is really important. God desires to bring his kingdom into every area of our lives. When we allow worry to make more impact on us. So some people are very worried about where our country is heading, and you can't say there's no reason not to, but what you can say is you can have a concern about it, but when it goes into an anxiety that makes you dysfunctional, you've blown it. You've gone too far. You've gone past what anything's acceptable. It's one thing to pray about something, pursue about something, and even participate in something. It's another thing to allow that thing to cripple you. And that's what Jesus is not allowing. It's like you don't know what's going to happen tomorrow. So what are you worried about tomorrow? And then people are talking about things that are happening in 2 months or 3 months. It's like, slow down, Sparky. You don't know what's going to happen this evening. I got a message for you. A lot of people don't like this message. It's too bad. You don't know what's going to happen in 2 minutes. You might get a text or a phone call that will change your life. You might be thinking, well, that would be something bad. Maybe somebody you know won the lottery. Maybe it'd be something good. Maybe you should just, we should all just go, whoa. And there's a futility in anxiety. Let me explain something to you. I'm going to bring in a psalm to kind of cross-pollinate this. Anxiety is futile because there's nothing that it will do to change anything. But truth breaks the power of things that anxiety taps into in our lives. And so when the scripture says something like, delight yourself in the Lord and he'll give you the desires of your heart, if you spend your time pursuing God, enjoying God, seeking God's kingdom first, it reduces the power that anxiety and futility have in your life because the Lord is in charge. And you're acknowledging that. And that goes back to the Proverbs 3, 5, and 6. Trust in the Lord with all your heart. Lean not on your own understanding. Why? Because our understanding's terrible. We think we know. If we knew that much, we'd be placing sports bets every day. We don't know that much. I'm just being honest. Like, stop. You can't afford to worry about tomorrow because you have no idea what's going to happen tomorrow. Let it go. What you need to do is seek him. What you need to, and when it says seek first his kingdom and his righteousness, there's some people that say, you know, walk in righteousness, and I don't think that's wrong at all, but the truth of the matter is Jesus is the righteousness that comes from God. So there's a kind of a hidden statement there by saying seek first his kingdom and his righteousness, which is Jesus Christ, who's the righteousness of God. It's like all these things will be added to you. He'll take care. He knows what you need. He knows what you're going. He knows what you can and cannot put up with. You know what's amazing about God is he knows what you really can and cannot take. People go, well, he won't give me more than I can handle. Yes, he will.
What do you mean?
He'll give you more than you can handle so that the only thing that can get you out of it is a miracle. So he can testify to him being connected to you. He does that all throughout Scripture. But what he knows is where your real breaking point is. He knows that too. See, he knows everything. And so stop worrying about what it's going to be tomorrow. We all, you know, in a certain sense, we hope there is a tomorrow, but in another sense, we hope the Lord comes back and there isn't tomorrow. So it's like, you don't know. I don't know. And stop acting like everybody knows, well, this has to happen. So immature. Wow, way to try to reduce the Sermon on the Mount. Here's what it is. We want the kingdom of God in every single area of our lives. We want the Lord to reign supreme. So when the scripture says in that beginning portion, which it talks about in the Sermon on the Mount, when it says, Our Father who art thou in heaven, hallowed be thy name, which is praise, glory, honor to the Lord. Thy kingdom come. Okay, well, what is it where God's kingdom comes? What is that? Thy will be done. So God's will being done is where his kingdom is, and you want his will being done in every area of your life, and you want that for your life. You want every area of your life to be under the kingship of God. But the issue for so many of us is we're so freaked out about what will or won't happen or what may or may not happen, or we have such a weird anticipatory spirit or attitude, we're oblivious. That he's saying, stop that. This is why Jesus said, Our Father art thou in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. As though it is for today. Oh, wait, it is. Because when you start trying to figure out tomorrow, you don't get that privileged information. Unless God has given you a moment for you to be a prophet and have shown you exactly how it's going to go. And by the way, if you proclaim some of the things you think were going to happen as a believer and acted like a prophet and you were wrong in the Old Testament, you would have been killed. God has a pretty high standard. And so whenever I say give an estimation, or whenever I say this might happen, this will happen, I will often say, I think, or could be. This is like, I ain't saying this for the Lord. The only thing I believe will happen is if the Lord tarries, the only prophetic thing I ever mention is how they're going after the Word of God. I mean, that's, and I don't have any problem with that. I feel strongly in my faith and in my convictions of Scripture to stand on that all day long, and the Lord's shown that to be true. So my point in saying all that is simply this. You have no idea what's going to happen. Then why are you trying to coordinate it? It's not wrong to make plans. It's wrong to make plans with fear. It's not wrong to plan. It's wrong to plan out of terror and fear and doubt. And it's wrong to make plans without God in the picture. That's wrong. As Noelle's doing her flower world, she's doing, we'll talk about that more later on. Her and I talked about that, and I mentioned this before. I told her, I said, this has got to be a partnership between you and God. It can't be between me and her and God as much as this is her vision, her desire, her drive. She has to have this between her and God. It's their partnership. That's what he wants. Instead of worrying about it or trying to figure out what's going to happen tomorrow or the day after tomorrow or 3 weeks from tomorrow, you deal with it today, hand in hand, in partnership with God. And some people are so anxious about what could be, what may be, that they're not living right now. They're frozen. And it's like, that is not the place to be. And on top of all that, we're supposed to be these people that believe that Jesus Christ died on the cross, he was buried, and 3 days later he rose again. That happened 2,000 years ago. Your faith is radical. Take that same radical faith and apply it to other principles in your life. Take that same radical I believe in Jesus faith to deal with your finances, your relationship, your situations, your children, your job. Take that same radical faith and use it for everything else. This is not about life insurance in the context of eternal life insurance. This is about a living relationship with a living God who wants to be a part of every area of our lives. He wants to be connected to you and I in everything. Dave, did you mean everything? Yes. Everything. Dave, everything. That's what he wants. When we get back, we're going to talk about the access point for that. It's not what you think it is. Okay, we'll take a break and then come back. You're listening to the David Spoon Experience right here on KAAM 770, the Truth Station here in Texas. Short break, we'll be back. Don't go anywhere.
What is the David Spoon Experience? Imagine yourself on a rocket ship racing at 1,000 miles an hour into space. Once there, you can sense the power and the presence of the majestic and the divine. You forget about your troubles and your fears, and you just float in peace without a worry in the world. There are no struggles, no pain, no discomfort. It's soothing, calm, comfortable. But then, the show starts. And you realize that none of that stuff has anything to do with the show. What were you thinking? The David Spoon Experience. Only for the brave of heart and the bored.
What is the David Spoon Experience, you say? I'll put it to you like this. Do you love a good joke that's pretty bad?
What do you call an animal that doesn't practice what it preaches? A hippocritopotamus. Come on.
Do you love being able to ask questions, comments, or having someone to pray for you?
If you have an opinion, a comment, a thought, or a question, we don't want it to die of loneliness. We want it to have a chance.
And last but not least, do you love some trivia?
All right, we got our trivia question. Who made clothes out of leaves that were sewed together? Somebody want to answer the trivia question? Oh, okay, hold on. Here we go. This is David. Who am I talking to?
We're talking to Mary.
This is Al.
This is Brother Ace.
This is Eric.
This is Deborah.
Now, if that doesn't make you curious, maybe you should tune in and check it out for yourself.
Think of me as the big brother that won't go away.
That's me.
Tune in to the David Spoon Experience weekdays at 1:30 p.m. on 770 KAAM.
Here's what I want you to get. Here's what I want you to understand. Bad news does not necessitate that there is nowhere else to go except to weep. In Psalm 112, verse 7, the scripture says, he will not fear bad news. His heart is confident, trusting in the Lord. It's not pie in the sky to look at the situation and go, gosh, it's terrible, but I'm going to hold hope because hope is the only thing I have to move past it. If it never comes about, that's fine, but I'm going to live every day believing that there's a better tomorrow. When people think of that, they think, "Oh, Christianity, it's a crutch. It's the opiate of the people," is what Karl Marx said. It takes more guts, more strength, more determination in this day and age to be a Christian and to stand in your faith than it does to be any other thing that there is, because it's the Christians who are under persecution and it's the people of faith that are getting slaughtered. And oh, by the way, throughout the world that's taking place. Welcome back to the David Spoon Experience. Thank you for joining us here at KAAM 770, the Truth Station here in Texas. That's KAAM 770, the Truth Station here in Texas. Here is your next trivia question. It is one we have asked before about 2 years ago. How about that? I am repeating a trivia question from 2 years ago. Simon Peter cut off the ear of the high priest's servant. Which ear did he cut off? John chapter 18, verse 10. Simon Peter cut off the ear of the high priest's servant. Which ear did he cut off? John chapter 18, verse 10. Such a great question. If you think you know, 972-445-0770. That's 972-445-0770. You can also text 214-210-8483. That's 214-210-8483. Or you can send an email, David@hemustincrease.org. That's David@hemustincrease.org. Now, normally I would send you up to the website, but I did that not that long ago, and I just don't feel like doing it. So let me just make this little plug, because we're not going to do the website music. Here, we can always use donations, because that's how the show runs. Okay? We had some people really step up, and we do appreciate that, but our bills are continual. As is Don's knock on my door going, rent time. And then my own landlord's rent time. You know, that's how we live. We live week to week, day to day. Well, that's actually how we live, ironically. In the meantime, I do want to do our history, because there's something, of course, very, very important. So let's do history real quickly, please. Let's go live in the past. All right, so most people know today is 9/11, and 9/11 is a very, very important day in the framework of our country and probably in the world itself because of how it impacted things. September 11th, 2001, the hijackers from the group of Al-Qaeda crashed two jets into the Twin Towers of the World Trade Center in New York City. Shortly after, both towers collapsed. Third jet crashed into the Pentagon. A fourth plane crashed into the rural field of Somerset County in Pennsylvania. The official count on that death at that time was 2,997, not including subsequent deaths that would happen afterwards. So very, very important today. That day, I remember very, very clearly that day because, and I told you this before, and it's not spiritual. Well, I don't want to say it's not spiritual, but there's many people that had just many, many fascinating stories. And that was one of the first Noelle and I moved into a house, and I never get up and check out the news. And for whatever reason, I got up, and the first thing I did was turn on the news and saw what was happening. It was so weird. It was, like, bizarre because I don't do that. And then doing that and watching that, and then so then I went into the bedroom saying, and then
woke Noelle up and said, get up, we're at war. Just like that's what I said, because it just seemed so, it was so intense. And then just so many people and so many stories, and it's just fascinating, and all the theories and conspiracies and whatever. Here's my response to those. Ready? That's all, folks. I mean, that's what I think about that kind of stuff. It's so ridiculous. Here's what I do think. I do think that it showed how vulnerable the entire world is. And if the world doesn't get it together and get on track, the time will be short. I think that's just fair to say. Okay? So I do want to point that out. Now, in addition to that, I will say this just real quickly. It is make your bed day. So I will remember the 9/11. I'm going to skip the make your bed day because that's just that's my answer. No.
Like, if you don't ever make your bed for some reason, I guess this is the day to do it, right?
Yeah, I guess. I mean, it's just the weirdest thing people come up with. I don't know. I can't help
Some of these we get for, you know, what was it? There's a part on the field. One of our fields is a have a bad day day.
Yeah.
And like,
yeah, it's like
some of the stuff that come up is like, wow, they really ran out of ideas. Whoever comes up with these days.
Yes, that's kind of how I feel it goes on the streets. So I'm just going to say this. So if you drive down the streets and you go further out towards the edge of any state, I'm not saying just Texas, any state specifically, even more so maybe even California. And as you get further out, you get to the it's the exit XYYZZ, and you're like, how lazy do you have to be to name an exit XYYZZ? What happened in the boardroom when they were naming streets? You couldn't just come up with another name. You're going to the end of the alpha. I always find stuff like that amazing. Look, what kind of meeting was that?
It must have been like a Friday. They were ready to go home for the weekend.
They were ready to
so
go.
They just, you know, thought
and
of something.
Enough. That's right. That's exactly right. All right. Here's your trivia question. Simon Peter cut off the ear of a high priest's servant. Which ear did he cut off? John chapter 18, verse 10. If you think you know, 972-445-0770. You can also text 214-210-8483 or send an email, david@hemustincrease.org. So I don't want to waste the time in the sense that, you know, there's other things I can talk about, but I do want to get into this one point on this message. And we're talking about, and I'm getting everybody's text, so just let you know, I'm logging everything. I'm just not responding right away. So just have to follow the bouncing ball for a little bit. We are talking about understanding that God wants to be king in every area of our lives. Okay? And so what I want you to understand is God is not interested in you and in your life on just Sundays and Wednesday nights. And you have to love like the Keith Green song where the No Compromise song where he says he's in the song, one of his lyrics is, I want more than Sundays and Wednesday nights, because if you can't come to me every day, don't bother coming at all. Very powerful, very challenging. And what the Lord wants is he wants us. He doesn't want, you think he wants your money or he wants this. He wants your heart. Tommy Barnett preached this phenomenal message, Tommy Barnett Sr. preached this phenomenal message for all the things that God wants from you and I. He wants your heart. That's what he wants. He wants you. You think God needs your money? Sure, I'm going to show you the guy is always can you. But you think God needs that? God wants you. That's what Jesus dying for us is about. So that we can hang together with God. He wants you. He wants me. He wants all of us. So what I want to do is I want to do a practical thing here. If you give me that moment. Give me my due for a second, okay? What is it that will give us an understanding of what gives us a place where we can begin to take an area of our lives and bring it into submission to the kingdom of God. In other words, what is it that we need to do? Let's say you have an area in your life. Let's say you do pretty good in finances, because everybody talks about that. Let's skip that for right now. Let's say you have a really bad element with fear regarding your children. Okay? I'm just trying to just show you any area you've got going on. Or maybe you're really concerned and you're actually afraid that you're not doing what God put you on earth to do. Or maybe you're just super concerned that every time you do this one thing, something bad comes from it. Or every time you get involved in a small group, something weird comes from it. And all that stuff. Whatever it is. Whatever area that would apply to you in. What's the first thing we need to do? The first thing that we need to do to bring that area into the realm or the kingdom of God? What's the first thing that needs to be done? Ready? I know you're gizzard. Okay, come on, go. Mark chapter 1, verse 14 through 15. Now, after John had been taken into custody, Jesus came into Galilee preaching the gospel of God and saying, "The time is fulfilled. The kingdom of God is at hand." I'll just stop right there. Okay, John's in jail. Jesus comes preaching his message. Oh, remember everything said was love, love, love. Yeah, watch this. The time is fulfilled. The kingdom of God is at hand. Repent and believe the gospel. Do you know the first thing that Jesus tells us to do with the kingdom of God at hand, the kingdom of God being near, is repent? Do you know everybody that thinks that Jesus just talked about love, that Jesus mentions love 48 times in the Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, but mentions Satan or the devil 59 times? You know that nobody ever talks about that, right? How he talked more about the devil than he did about love. Why? Well, it's numbers don't lie. It's people that use numbers that lie. That's why. And so here comes his first message. The time is fulfilled. The kingdom of God is at hand. Repent. And now you're thinking, okay, wait, Spoon Man. Wait. Repent? I got to put a sign on and sandwich sign on and go on the corner and I got to, no, because that's not what repent means. Repentance, by definition, is metanoia. I hate this word. Metanoia. That's the word. Metanoia. And it means, listen to what it means, change the mind. Did you know that that's what repent means? Repentance in society often is this, and I saw this illustrated at a church. A person's walking down the street. The Lord says repent. The person goes, oh, okay, and then they just keep walking. That's not repentance. That's paying attention to it and then ignoring it. The purest form of repentance is to conform to God's way of thinking on whatever it is. So real repentance often brings a change of direction because it brings a change of thinking. It creates a different change of approach because God is redirecting. So I want you to hear this scripture. So I just want you to know, because this is all, you know, like kind of combined in, and just bear with me. It's just how the show's going. This one really powerful thing where in Isaiah, it's like, here's what God says in Isaiah 55. Ho, everyone that thirsts, come to the waters. You who have no money, come buy and eat. Come buy wine and milk without money, without cost. Why do you spend money for what is not bread, for your wages and for your wages that do not satisfy? Listen carefully to me and eat what is good. Delight yourself in abundance. Incline your ear and come to me. Listen that you may live. Further in that verse it says, for my thoughts are not your thoughts, nor are my ways your ways, declares the Lord. For as the heavens are higher than the earth, so my ways higher than yours and my thoughts higher than yours. In other words, we need to get on God's page in every area. In every area of our lives. Now, am I saying that you're going to do that perfectly after hearing this message? Nope. But you got to start. And yes, we did this starting point where we all said yes to Jesus and we yielded, we acknowledged, we asked for forgiveness, we recognized our foolishness. But now, as you, and I was talking to my brother about this yesterday, you got saved, and you're just like, I wish he would have raptured me the second after I got saved. Well, the problem with that is you're the billboard for God. So he is using you to reflect Jesus Christ. And what that means is every single area of your life, in your existence, has to come under the kingship of God. And that requires repentance or change of mind to align with his. Think about that. Doesn't matter what area. See, that's the point. One area after another, which is why 2 Corinthians 3:17 and 18 talk about that it's glory by glory that we are transformed into the image of Christ. Oh, you reflect Jesus, but that's an ongoing process. All right, we're going to take a break. I'm going to give you the trivia answer. So we're going to give you that trivia answer real fast, and that answer is his right ear. When we come back, we're going to do DNA and finish off the message. You're listening to the David Spoon Experience right here on KAAM 770, the Truth Station here in Texas. Short break. We'll be back. Don't go anywhere.
Since the dawn of the internet, people have been looking for a website they can be proud of without costing an arm or a leg. People want a quality website to promote their ministry, business, hobby, or passion. Introducing Cowpunch Sites. Cowpunch Sites can help you create and maintain a quality website. From design to security, Cowpunch does it all. Cowpunch is a family-owned and operated business, taking a fresh approach to business. Lots of clients at lower prices. Make mom happy.
The most significant benefit of working with Cowpunch Sites is that you work with real people, not cheesy templates. No outsourcing. It's $57 a month, and there's no setup fee and no cancellation fees. When you go to cowpunchsites.com/dad. That's cowpunchsites.com/dad. That's me. Oh, did I mention that it's $57 a month? Cowpunch Sites, $57 a month, and that's no bull.
Dave, this is a nice radio station.
Oops, sorry. That's Cowpunch Sites, $57 a month, and that's no baloney. There, that's better. Cowpunchsites.com/dad.
Who is David Spoon? I have no idea. People have asked me about the David Spoon Experience. They wanted to know what I thought of him. Like any person searching for answers, I have wondered about him. He was born and raised Jewish, and after intense drug use, became a Christian. He's married to his best friend Noel, has 3 children, 6 grandchildren, and a dog named Bert. He has 3 separate ordinations from 3 different denominations, and is a summa cum laude for his BA degree in ministry and leadership, as well as a master's degree of theological studies, and has his doctorate of strategic Christian ministry. He has a weird sense of humor and talks a lot. If people are seeking wisdom and insight from the great teachers around the world, would they go to David? No, I don't think so. And those big ears really don't help him. But would they enjoy his perspective on life, culture, politics, food, sports, local and national news? I don't know. I guess people will have to listen to find out.
What is the David Spoon Experience?
Jesus' longest sermon that's recorded is Matthew chapter 5, 6, and 7, which takes about 25 to 30 minutes long. It takes about 30 minutes to read Matthew 5, 6, and 7. So here's a lesson for pastors and preachers everywhere. Jesus said everything he wanted to say on the Sermon on the Mount in 30 minutes. Paul took 12 hours. God didn't record a single word.
The David Spoon Experience on 770 KAAM.
Sometimes hallelujah.
Oh, welcome back to the David Spoon Experience. Thank you for joining us here at KAAM 770, the Truth Station here in Texas. That's KAAM 770, the Truth Station here in Texas, where we're going to launch right away with our DNA. Otherwise, I could miss it, and I don't want to do that today. D stands for draw closer to the Lord.
Daily.
Every day that you breathe, spend time with God, or you're hurting yourself. Period. and never be ashamed of Jesus or his words. Never be ashamed. God created the universe. The dude knows how to write a book. I mean, come on. That's just a no-brainer for us. It should be a no-brainer anyway. And then A, always be ready.
To serve.
To serve. Ready? 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 Yes, and always be ready. Get it? Yes, I know that's irritating. That's why I did that. D, draw closer to the Lord daily and never be ashamed of Jesus or his words. A, always be ready to serve. Here's your last trivia question, and you only have 2 minutes or 3 minutes if you're calling. Otherwise, text in. Which Bible author wrote A Little Leaven Leaveneth the Whole Lump? A Little Leaven Leaveneth the Whole Lump. Which well-known Bible author wrote that? If you think you know and you want to call, make it quick, 972-445-0770. You can also text 214-210-8483 or send an email, david@hemustincrease.org. Okay? All right. Now, the reason I'm hurrying it up is because I only got 5 minutes left, and this message still has to close. So just so you can know, that's why I'm doing that, okay? Because I have to close. I have to finish this. Can't leave you hanging, right? What Bible author said, a little leaven leaveneth the whole lump, which is really quite interesting in lieu of what we're teaching on in regarding the kingdom of God. So we talked about the kingdom of God, that it is God's desire. It is specifically mentioned in the Sermon on the Mount that the truth is that God wants to be king in every area in our lives. We're supposed to pray for, thy will be done, thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. That is supposed to be our approach. And then we understand and got into the discussion that through, repentance, not just Mark 1:14 through 15, but Matthew 4:17 also, Jesus said, repent. For the kingdom of heaven is near. In other words, twice Jesus said that. Everybody goes, well, Jesus came and said, love, love, love. No, he didn't. He came and said, repent. That was his first message. I'm just saying, you can't change it. You can't change the truth, people. It's there. But what we did talk about is understanding what repentance is. It's not just, I like goofy movies and the Monty Python thing where they're walking and they're taking a board and hitting themselves and walking in a line. That's funny. It's not what repentance is, but it's funny. It means to change the mind in its purest form. And boy, Isaiah 55, 1 through 9 is really a great way to see it. Repentance means to conform to God's way of thinking. So that's just like, ooh, that's crucial. That's so big. But I want you to see something that comes with repentance in regards to areas that we're struggling with or need help with. Acts 3, 17 through 19. And now, brethren, I know that you acted in ignorance just as your rulers did. But the things that God announced beforehand by the mouth of all the prophets, that as Christ would suffer, has thus been fulfilled. Therefore, repent and return so that your sins may be wiped out, in order that times of refreshing may come from the presence of the Lord. What people miss often is that when we come before the Lord and say, I got to change my thinking into your thinking, I surrender, I yield, I repent, that when we do that before the Lord blesses us with times of refreshing. How many of you need a good old-fashioned refreshment? How many of you need to have a fresh spring shower just move over you in the spiritual world? Hey, guess where that comes from? You turning your face to the Lord and changing your thinking to conform to his thinking so his kingdom is done in your life in all areas and in specific areas. Repentance, people make it like it's something bad. It's the greatest thing ever. Because when you repent, you say, I'm done, it's you. And the Lord goes, that's a good call. Now I'm going to help you. Who doesn't need the help of God? I don't know about you guys, but As long as I've done this walk, the one thing I figure out is whenever it's less of me and more of him, it's a lot better.
That's the one thing. The one thing I can tell you that I can absolutely testify that will never change. When there's less of me and more of him in me, it's a lot better. The walk is a lot better. The life is about a lot better. The existence is a lot better. And so why that's important is for you and I to get on his page. Like, look, if you turn to me and you come to me and you change your thinking to my thinking, and you know, I'm gonna wash you clean. You're gonna be like washed. Like, it's like, you know, everybody knows what this. You go through a car wash when your car is like kind of, you know, a little bit of a wreck. At least I do when it's a wreck. That car comes out. What does it look like? It looks clean. Almost looks brand new. Whoa, look at that. That's you with the Lord when you repent. It's like you're going through a car wash. You like that? That's a good one right there if you think about it. It's like, yeah, it's like refreshing. Only in my way of thinking, for me personally, I think that refreshment, that's like a big old glass of either lemonade or something to quench my thirst when I am just like parched. Well, that's what repentance does. It refreshes us because it brings the presence of the Lord. Because when you repent, you acknowledge he's in charge and you want to do it his way. And he likes that. After all, he is in charge. By the way, which Bible author said a little leaven leaveneth the whole lump? That answer is Paul. 1 Corinthians 5:6 and Galatians 5:9 both will tell you that, just in case you're wondering. So here's my admonition. Seek first the kingdom of God, and everything else should be added unto you. Seek that which God's will is done. To do that, repent and change your way to God's thinking. And watch the refreshment come from the Most High God. All right, folks, you've been listening to the David Spoon Experience right here on KAAM 770, the Truth Station here in Texas. 22.5-hour break. Then we'll come back. More Insanity with Spoonanity. Talk to you then.
Can't stand the skill, can't stand the shame. It may be false, but it feels the same.
Views and opinions expressed in the preceding program are those of its participants and do not necessarily reflect those of KAAM, DJRD Broadcasting, or its sponsors.